The Thatcher's own voice had an emotional edge to it.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're leaving Downing Street for the last time after 11 and a half wonderful years, and we're very happy that we leave the United Kingdom in a very, very much better state than when we came here 11 and a half years ago.
In November of 1990, after 11 years as Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher felt she had no choice but to resign. Her position had become untenable. But what were the events that led to her downfall? I'm Anita Rani, and this is Beneath the Crown. On the 31st of March 1990, a crowd of around 250,000 people descended on London's Trafalgar Square. They were there to protest against Margaret Thatcher's new community charge tax the day before it was introduced. It turned into a full-scale riot. The shocking scenes became known as the Battle of Trafalgar, with a reported 339 arrests and over 100 police officers needing treatment for injuries. The public outcry about the controversial community charge, also called the poll tax, went on for months, with Thatcher as the focal point. The tax required every adult to pay a fixed rate sum every year set by their local authority, and it was the same whether you lived in a tiny house or a £1 million mansion. Much of the public and Conservative Party felt it was biased against the poor, and it proved to be a political disaster. The knives were out for Thatcher. The public's opinion of her was tumbling, and polls suggested Labour were on course to win the next election.
No! Yeah. No! Yeah. No!
Thatcher was increasingly detached from the people she'd worked so closely with for years, and she feared some were even plotting her downfall. Even her husband Dennis felt it was time for her to call it a day. But Margaret Thatcher felt there were no worthy successors to inherit her legacy, and she vowed to fight on.
A recent farm visit brought this response to suggestions she was about to resign.
Poppycock.
Her enemies in the party smelt blood. Former Chancellor Geoffrey Howe had been the architect of Thatcher's political revolution, so it was only fitting he was the catalyst for her downfall. Disillusioned with her hostile attitudes towards the EU and humiliated with a demotion, Howe decided to strike back. He resigned. Then he had free rein to deliver a devastating resignation speech to a packed House of Commons on November the 13th. He ferociously criticised Thatcher, who sat in stony silence throughout. Howe's speech was branded heroic, although some of the Conservative Party despised him for it. He was even spat on in the Commons corridors immediately afterwards. Howe's scathing words inspired Thatcher's bitter rival, Michael Heseltine, to take action the next morning.
I must ask you, do you expect a leadership challenge?
Like Howe, Heseltine was a strong supporter of more integration with Europe. His policies were generally disliked by Thatcher, as was his showmanship, and she was notably absent for many of his speeches. Heseltine harboured a long-term ambition to be Prime Minister, and the time had come for him to strike. He announced his candidacy for the leadership, stating that over 100 MPs had urged him to stand. Thatcher underestimated the threat and failed to canvass her colleagues for support before the leadership vote on November the 20th. She did defeat Heseltine, 204 votes to his 152, but for an outright victory, she needed a majority of 15%. It wasn't enough.
Naturally, very pleased that I got more than half the parliamentary party and disappointed that it's not quite enough to win on the first ballot. So I confirm it is my intention to let my name go forward for the second ballot.
A second ballot meant that others could now put their names forward as leader, with John Major and Douglas Hurd throwing their hats in the ring. Rumours swirled that many MPs were planning to switch their allegiance away from Thatcher. Privately, the strain was taking its toll. Thatcher was on the ropes, But on November the 21st, she declared, "I fight on. I fight to win." Cabinet ministers publicly showed support and insisted she'd win the leadership battle. However, those same ministers tried to persuade her to go when she summoned them one by one to ask for their support. The penny was beginning to drop for the Iron Lady, painfully.
Power is nothing without authority. And at this moment, your cabinet is against you.
Thatcher did what many of us have done when faced with a crucial, life-changing decision. She slept on it. At 9 a.m. on November the 22nd, the cabinet assembled for a meeting at Downing Street. There sat Margaret Thatcher, red-eyed, with a box of tissues by her side. The only woman in cabinet, she addressed the people around her and announced her decision to withdraw from the second ballot and step down as leader. She stressed the need for both party unity and a win in the next election. And she was overwhelmed with emotion and struggled to finish her speech. Others offered to read the rest of it on her behalf, but she persevered. As the significance of the moment sunk in, other eyes in the room welled up too.
I had people coming to see me who were absolutely marvellous, who begged me to go on. I had people in tears at the thought that if I didn't. But the fact was, I did not get to on the first ballot. The fact was that it wasn't good enough.
The public reactions to the resignation highlighted the polarised views of Thatcher throughout her time in power. Michael Heseltine was slightly more measured in his response.
And may I say at once that this brings to an end a quite remarkable premiership.
That afternoon, Margaret Thatcher gave her final speech as Prime Minister in the Commons. She was in a defiant mood.
Mr. Speaker, all these are grounds for congratulation, not censure, least of all from the Right Honourable Gentleman.
Thatcher couldn't formally leave her role until her successor as Prime Minister was elected. She spent her final days in her position rallying support for her Chancellor, John Major. She was encouraged by how he'd worked his way up from a working class background and his pledge to create a classless society. Major went on to defeat Heseltine and Hurd to become, at 47, the youngest Prime Minister for 95 years. On November the 28th, it was time for the Thatchers to bid farewell to Downing Street, not just to her place of work for so many years, but also their family home.
It's been a tremendous privilege to serve this country as Prime Minister. Wonderfully happy years, and I'm immensely grateful to the staff who've supported me so well.
After 11 years and 208 days as Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher's divisive reign was at an end. She felt betrayed by the way she'd been treated by the party, her party, which she'd led to 3 consecutive election victories. She felt devastated after what she'd achieved, rising from unprivileged beginnings to becoming the nation's first female leader. The absence of the power she once wielded was to leave a huge, unfillable void in her life. But there was some form of consolation that came from an unlikely source. The Queen, often labelled her nemesis, awarded her the treasured Order of Merit, the only honour the Queen picks herself. The pair didn't always enjoy a smooth relationship, but politics were cast aside in favour of acknowledging Thatcher's dedication to serving the nation.
Now it's time for a new chapter to open, and I wish John Major all the luck in the world.